Hi guys, this is Tim Norton from CCTV Design. Having a couple of webcam issues today, so sorry about the slightly out of focus image, but we're looking today at the Vivotek FE8171V hemispherical camera. Now, as you might have read on my blog, I've given hemispherical cameras a fairly bad review in the past, but that's mainly because the sales paraphernalia tries to put them into being able to do stuff they really can't do. So I'm hoping today to go through and look at what the camera actually can achieve, how good or bad it is, and give an unbiased viewpoint on it. So stay tuned in and we'll work through it. Thanks. So we're about to open up the Vivotek hemispherical 360 degree camera. So we'll just go through the box, see what's included. I haven't had a look at one of these yet. As you've seen, I've done bad reviews on them before, so it'd be interesting to get a first-hand touch and feel rather than just looking at someone's demo. So we've got a nice note from our supplier, ADI. Thank you, Rachel. The setup CD. I've done one other type of Vivotek camera. The setup was very easy using the CD, so hopefully this will be the same. Alignment bases, we've got two different ones, one for camera base and for mounting plate, so it looks like we can mount the camera either direct or with its mounting plate. Warranty cards, hopefully not needed. Application note for Milestone X Protect users, not using that for our testing. Installation manual looks a little bit daunting, kind of thick, but it is in multiple languages, so it's only 12 pages of English, which isn't too bad. If you're like me, you probably won't read it anyway, but we'll probe around and see what we can find out before we hit that point. So getting down to the nuts and bolts, we've got the camera itself. First impressions, it's quite a solid feel. It's got a little hole here, I'm guessing that's a microphone or something, or maybe a reset button. Security screws. On the back we've got, I presume that's the cable gland, not sure what that spot is there. But yeah, it feels solid, it's a nice feeling camera. Quite a low profile. And next in the box we have the mounting base. Now the mounting base doesn't feel as solid as the camera itself. It might be a little bit of a weakness if you have to surface mount it. The actual brackets are all cast, but I think you could quite easily snap that off if you gave it a solid hit, whereas the camera itself does feel that it could withstand a nice hit. So that just clips on somewhere on the bottom here, like so. Adds a bit of profile, means you can get your cables in. So I guess you'd only use that if you're on a concrete slab or something of that nature. Cables, I'm guessing we've got power, got some binary I.O. on there. Strange power supply by the looks, 3.3 volts. Not sure what the black one is, but those two will be our audio in and out, and at the other end the connector to go inside the camera. It's on a threaded finish, so that's probably what the second hole on the back here was for. I'm guessing that'll thread straight into that hole. Power supply. So the power supply looks like we've got a heap of different types of plugs. So I think that's America, UK, Australia and China. Don't know. And the power supply itself is, it's 12 volt 1.5 amp, so obviously the input on that cable is not for the power supply. So I'm hoping it's PoE, I'm pretty sure it will be, but we'll find out. We've got cable gland of some sort and some mounting screws, and feels like a bag of silica gel. Screwdriver for the security screws. And that looks like it. So that is what we get in the box. So we'll jump into it, turn the camera off for a minute, and we'll start playing around. Next up, we're going to open the camera itself up. Apologies that my webcam doesn't seem to be focusing as well as it should, but we'll just have to persist with that because that's all I've got today. So we'll get into it. So as I've said before, I'm not a big fan of 360 cameras. I think where they're marketed as being useful for and what they're actually useful for don't align properly. So the main reason I'm looking at this is to give a real feel for what we can actually identify a person at or recognize a person. You know, if we mount it at 2 meters, I believe we'll probably get identification at about 2 meters away from the camera. But it's just to confirm those sorts of things. Okay, so inside, first thing I notice is a bag of silica gel. It's physically stickied in there, so I don't know if that's meant to stay or not, but we've got a safety lanyard so that the camera and the lid don't fall off and bang someone on the head. Looks like what I thought was a microphone is a microphone. So the front there, we've got that little pimple. It's connected through just through some pressure contacts into the back. Looks like they touch onto 2 pins here. And then we've got our connectors for presumably the alarms and so forth. And cable entry, obviously the lens, quite a wide lens for the hemispherical. A waterproof gland all the way around, so it does look reasonably watertight. One of the big problems I've seen with these sorts of cameras is water ingress into the back, so we'll see how well this gland combination. So that's just a pressurized gland. I don't believe that would actually keep any water out, and the fact it's countersunk is quite a problem. That water's going to track in, follow the cables, sit around that gland, and because it's, sorry, you can't see that, so it's going to track in, sink into that hole there. And because this gland is not really a tight fit, it is going to ingress straight through there unless we silicone it up. So that's my first criticism of the camera. The other hole is screwed in. I'm going to have to get myself a different screwdriver to open that, but I believe that is to fit the cables. So I'll just grab those cables down here on the floor. So we've got this threaded gland, which again, the water is going to track straight down and into that unless we put a lot of silicone on it. So a bit of a design flaw, but you know, not a game stopper, just something that you have to be aware of while you're installing. Now I'm going to take the silica gel off because it really is in the way and it's probably going to spill everywhere as I do it. So as I said, I don't know if that's meant to stay there because it is glued in, but at the moment it's in my way. So we'll just take it off and we'll start to power it up in a minute. So I've got the camera powered up and I just want to show you another small design issue. What we've got is where the RJ45 goes in. So it comes up through the hole. I've managed to get it in with a boot already on there, but you'd probably be terminating in the camera, so that won't really be an issue anyway. The RJ45, it's right behind where that silica gel was sticky taped. And one of the problems I see is we've got the seal here. To get my RJ45 to stay out the way of that, I've really got to put quite a hard bend on it. Now, if that was Cat 6 cable, the bend radius has more than likely been exceeded. If I didn't have the boot, yes, it would be a little bit shorter, but that's probably something that in their cable management could be done a little bit better. So putting that aside, we've powered the unit up. I've just put it on my PoE switch here. We've got it coming in on port 1. Out on the other end, we've got it going off to my PC. And this is just a off-the-shelf Linksys, unprogrammed, ready to go. So we'll jump over to the software and see what we can do.